Okay, so again, welcome everyone to WFD5. My name is Hemant Chaskar. I am the VP for technology at Airtight. I have been with the company since very beginning and have seen this company go through the all phases of security, cloud, access point generations. You had a chance to see the very detailed demonstrations of our management console, but what I am going to talk about is little bit overview of the back-end cloud infrastructure that we have built to support this whole management console. And as a matter of fact, we launched our first cloud managed product back in 2008. And since then, we have been kind of innovating and building on top of it to arrive at a very mature cloud infrastructure on the back end that we have today, which I will show you how we do it on the back end. Now, I will not go into how to get the word cloud into your solution. There are different tricks like cloud hosted, cloud activated. Our concept is that when you say cloud managed Wi-Fi, it's a Wi-Fi management plane that is hosted in the cloud, which supports full-fledged network management in there. That's our concept of a cloud. And the way we build it, we also have carefully chosen the platforms which are most appropriate for cloud implementation. Moving boxes and blades to the data center is not optimal for cloud implementation, and as we'll see. So the platform choice is also important, right? And the functionality that is provided is also important. So we do the cloud managed Wi-Fi, right? So to that effect, today we operate 6 data centers worldwide, and they are hosted with the infrastructure provider that is in the leader magic quadrant for Gartner. Now, what that means is that this is a very high-end cloud infrastructure where this management plane is hosted. And one design choice we made from beginning is that we will not build cloud on top of appliances and blades, but we will do a fully virtualized implementation. And today we really realize that we made a good decision, because the amount of efficiency and economics you get out of full virtualization is tremendous. And this value is going to finally pass to the customer in terms of the reduced cost of overall solution, right? So it's fully virtualized, and it runs on today VMware ESXi platform, hypervisor platform. Now, let me dig a little deeper into what lies inside each data center. So this is like overall picture of what data center hosts. At the front end, you see this service discovery layer, and I will talk about each of these components in next 10 minutes. Behind that, what you see is a multi-tenant or super tenant, and I will again explain that, manager instances. Then you see a separate guest manager and analytics engine, and the whole architecture is supported by several levels of fault tolerance, HA, and disaster recovery, which again I will talk about in next 10 minutes. So let's start with service discovery layer. And the job of this layer is to ensure that your Airtight devices, APs, and the management console, they will always find their right manager instance in this big cloud, right? Wherever they are connected to the internet. So Sean connected this AP here. How does it know where its manager instance lies? So that job is performed by this service discovery layer. And what it actually contains, it has the database which maps all these devices and customers to their respective manager instances in the big cloud. Now, it's important that this database is replicated. So it's replicated across all data centers, and it's always synchronized, which means that these devices and console, they can hit any data center, and they will still find their right manager instance in the backend cloud. So it's highly resilient in that perspective. It also receives input from the provisioning module, which basically ensures that the total cloud capacity, right, is utilized in an optimal fashion by assigning the right devices and management consoles to the right manager instances. Moving further, behind the service discovery layer, what you see is the manager instances. And the job of manager instance is to ensure that when these devices connect to the cloud, or when they are connected to the cloud, they always get up-to-date policy information, the configuration information. And also, I need to collect statistics from them. If it is AP statistics, if it is security events, if it is the visibility analytics, and so on. So the job of manager instance is to make sure that the policies are pushed down and the stats is collected in the other direction, right? So let's, and it also provides, by the way, the console, the GUI console into your whole network. That's also the job of manager instance. Now, each of these instances is actually a virtual machine. They are not servers. So each of them has this compute and memory at a front end on an ESXi architecture. And we deploy them either in N plus 1 or 1 plus 1 redundant fashion. Now, when you have N plus 1 redundancy, what that means is that there is always a secondary instance that can take over from any of those N running instances if any one of them were to fail. So that gives you high availability, and combine that with the fact that this is a very high-end cloud infrastructure, right? So we make sure that these instances will not fail in practice. And with N plus 1 redundancy, what you're also getting is the benefit of sharing, because you're not putting an extra secondary for every primary. And that again goes down to the reduced cost of overall solution. For some customers who want 1 plus 1 redundancy, we can also configure that, where you have a standby server instance or a manager instance, either locally or in a remote data center, which is in complete sync with the primary. And then the instance is automatically handed off to the secondary if primary were to fail. And that gives you both fault tolerance and disaster recovery. But remember, it's over-provisioning by 100%, okay? So you have to pay for that kind of redundancy a little more. And each of these instances have the disk, which is in the EMC SAN. SAN is 100% available. Go ask EMC how they do it, but it's guaranteed to be 100% available. In addition to that, the disks are configured as RAID 5. Now, this is another advantage of virtualization compared to appliances, that if you had appliances, you would have two disks, 100% mirroring for redundancy, 100% overhead of storage. When you use RAID 5, you are giving same redundancy with 50% or less overhead of disk. You can, we do it with three disks, so it's 50% efficiency right there. And each of the instances is multi-tenant that we saw already in our GUI. But I want to highlight this concept of super-tenancy. So what is super-tenancy? When the customers become so large that the volume of the devices they have, it goes beyond the capacity that any single service instance can handle. Even if it is cloud, there are limits on vertical scalability, right? What do you do? The challenge still is that, and they don't want different management consoles for their different islands. They still want to manage these tens of thousands of devices from a single console, but this capacity is too much for one manager instance to handle, right? Then we bring in the concept of super tenancy, where we create these graphs. Think of graphs as the connections which provide management information, share management information, policy information, the information that is rendered on GUI between these instances. But they are all autonomous in terms of managing the devices that are connected to them. And that allows us to basically scale to tens of thousands of devices from single pane of glass, the location tree that you saw. It could be an MSP, or it could be a very large customer by itself.
So how, in each of these instances that you've got running, how many clients are you able to, APs are you able to get the data from?
Okay, so again, interesting question. It's not a concept of a server, so it's a configurable server. We can configure it for 100, 1,000, but when it goes beyond tens of thousands, let's say more than 5,000.
Have you actually tested that?
Oh yeah.
That many? Because we had a presentation a couple of wireless field days before from a company that was bought by a group, big green vendor, and they were talking about some of the challenges.
Yeah, there are challenges, yes.
Multiple loads, thousands, tens of thousands of APs coming into server instances and being able to handle the load.
Exactly.
Just that much data being sent.
There are challenges, and that's why this is not moving appliances to the cloud. That's why I say. So if you look at that, each service instance is autonomous, so that way it's parallelized. But when you're looking at a console, you know, in the location tree, it could be a location or a server. You don't know if it is a server behind a location or it's just that same server. That thing ties everything together in one kind of console at the end of the day. But they are still managing their devices independently. They have access to the same disk in the SAN.
What about at the micro scale? You said each instance is provisioned. You can provision them small, medium, large, if you will, right?
Yeah.
What happens if your customer outgrows a small provisioning? does that grow on the fly? Is that automatically resizable? How is that?
So as the customer grows, there's a provisioning module, I told you. It gives input to the service discovery module to reroute these devices if the new capacity were to be created for that server. If it is on the same server, service instance, I should call. And if it is exceeding its capacity, then the provisioning module has intelligence to tell the service discovery layer that these devices now move to a different server instance because they will occupy the capacity of the entire service instance.
Okay.
And if they go beyond that, then the provisioning module will do the super tenancy configuration between the server instance.
And how is that productized and sold, or is it completely transparent?
It's done by, you know, your support has to be involved a little bit in that. You are not doing it completely automated, but as the devices are growing, this configuration is done by cloud operator team.
Cloud operator.
Yeah, in our.
Is that pretty seamless, or is there an interruption in?
No, so the devices actually are able to operate independently at the edge. They don't depend on a manager. When they find that the old manager is not reachable, they will go to the service discovery layer and automatically get transferred to the new server. So it's seamless from that perspective, yeah.
But I mean, from I'm managing my analytics and things like that.
That will all move seamless. So the back end is, it's just a separate disk, so it has nothing to do with the...
So slightly related, how big is your biggest customer?
So I will, Anthony, want to mention?
I'm not like 17,000 locations, we're about 10,000.
You're not here.
We're currently, our largest customer has 17,000 unique locations. We're about better than midway through the deployment, so we're at about 10,000 deployed.
Is that access layer or?
Yeah, that's APs.
APs, okay.
So moving on, I will mention these two things very quickly because we are out of time. So the guest manager and analytics engine, it generates very high volume of data. So it is architected on a distributed database concept, which is a NoSQL database, which supports sharding. Sharding meaning you can split your whole data set into multiple shards, which run on distinct virtual machines. And then the computation is done by way of query redirector, who redirects the queries to the appropriate shards, right? So that allows us to, that will allow us and in future to scale this analytics data to very, very large data sets and allow more widgets and more kind of interpreted information available in the guest manager that you saw. The final point I want to mention is about high availability and disaster recovery. And this comes up often. Now, one concept, interesting, distinct concept we have here is a sliding scale. So I already told you about 1+1 redundancy, where you can have a running instance and a secondary instance in local or remote database, right? That gives you local fault tolerance as well as disaster recovery. Everyone doesn't need that kind of redundancy because disasters are relatively rare. Disasters are earthquakes, lightnings, man-made disasters. So for them at the other extreme, what you can do, we can do is provide the local redundancy as N+1, then you are getting the benefits of sharing. And for the disaster situations, we are taking backups of their data multiple times in a day. And these backups are replicated on a remote data center. Okay? So it's highly unlikely with these high-end cloud infrastructures that your local data centers will fail. But if there is a calamity, there is an earthquake, then we can start all these service instances remotely using that backed up database. And this causes, you know, gives us great redundancy with very, very small overhead. So you are running N+1, and also you are replicating the databases.
So speaking of outages, you said earlier that there's a local user interface on the AP for configuration. How do you do configuration sync if during an outage or during a disconnect to the NMS platform, if somebody configures something that they shouldn't have, right? How do you lock those, or how do you make them dependent, or how do you even reconcile those?
So realistically speaking, you know, this with this N+1 redundancy and what cloud infrastructure is, you will not going to lose access to the management console unless there's a disaster. If there is a disaster.
What if my ISP goes down?
Yeah.
Well, then the APs are remembering their last policy, both for traffic and security. Continue to enforce that, and any stats and events that need to be pushed up, they're buffered until you regain the connectivity. But we don't recommend that you go to the local mode and reconfigure those AP there. Because you are remembering your last configuration, your edge is not failing.
Wait, so go back. You said there's a local mode? Like I can configure one if I say for whatever reason
you
stop
can.
Paying for my
subscription. You can.
is it limited or fully?
Well, but then you don't get the visibility into whole console in a single pane of glass, the templates, the benefits of having a centralized console.
Right, but my hardware is not useless if I...
No, it's not useless. Okay. Or you can move your service instance into a local data center if you want, if you don't want to keep in a public facility. That's another unique thing. It's not cloud only. It's cloud as well as on-site if you want to.
So if the link goes down between the APs and the management server, is it the standard situation where currently associated clients stay associated?
They stay associated.
New ones can't join?
New clients can join. Captive portals will be served. Handoffs will happen, security policy will be enforced, new rogues will be detected, prevented, events will be buffered. And that's the great thing, you know, customers get peace of mind because of that, because they know that their critical infrastructure is actually not so much dependent on the cloud.
Let's say you're in a branch office and your authentication is centralized and your WAN link goes down and you can't authenticate through AD.
But that's kind of if the internet connection is down, right? It's not our cloud service is down. I'm talking about our cloud service being down. Okay. So that's highly available, yeah.
What about things like your security solution and the analytics? Does the AP cache any of that?
Yes.
Outages for a period of time?
Yes. So, and that's the management server. As I said, at the edge, it's 100% available always because they don't depend on management server for their traffic forwarding, security, or services offered to the traffic. And I also talked about the service discovery network, which is very resilient, right? So that's kind of, sorry for speaking very fast, but I think we're out of time, and I want to go to the conclusion. You know, some observations I want you to kind of appreciate from this architecture. We have designed it as cloud, ground up, for scalability, I told you reliability, which is various levels of high availability and disaster recovery and flexibility. You do 1+1, N+1, you know, we offer a lot of flexibility. And scales from, you know, few devices to tens of thousand devices. I described the concept of multi-tenancy, right? And a single graphical user interface. And efficiency of cloud backend operation. That's what we have focused on all the time, because the more efficient the cloud backend is, the benefits are going to pass to the customer in terms of cost of solution and reliability. So those are the three points I want to mention in our design decisions.
You had a graphic up earlier with your six locations. You don't have to bring it back up, but it's not your data centers, you're just...
No, we are hosting with the what called IaaS, Infrastructure as a Service Provider. It's a very high end, it's in the magic quadrant.